April 27th, APC Area Plan Commission for Carroll County. Call the meeting to order. We'll start with the introduction of members. Cameron, we'll start down with you.
Cameron Hayes, Carroll County Area Plan Director.
Meeting, Burlington Yeoman, representing.
Carroll Watson, representing for the commission.
Mary Ann Burton, Mayor of Delphi.
Brad Barr, Carroll County Council.
Craig Walker, representing schools.
Steve Flora, Delphi City Council.
Steve Harmon, legal counsel.
We got Kelsey back there. Kelsey's back there today, Mark. Come on, Kelsey.
Yeah.
I saved a seat for you.
Kelsey Cole, A&R Engineer.
Okay. Moving on to approval of minutes from the February 23rd meeting. Do I have any updates or corrections? Do I have a motion to accept? Do I have a motion to approve the minutes from the last meeting? Again, for a second. Second, Doug, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are approved from the last meeting. Moving on to the next item on our agenda. Cameron, you want to give us the overview of this?
So we have obviously met prior to regards to the subdivision, I think our last meeting was October. On July 8th, 2019, Chad Crane submitted an application to rezone the property from Ag to L1, create a residential subdivision called Eagle View Estates. There are two easements that impact the parcel that will remain. Utilities, sewer line, all easements for ingress, egress will be situated along the west property line and benefits the existing sewer treatment plant, which is kind of where we've had several discussions. Staff received, this is a letter from prior meeting we have. We received a letter opposing subdivision and several phone calls requesting information about the number of lots. So for this particular meeting, we have a petition that was filed from the, make sure I pronounce this correctly, President of the Corporation, which is also known as White Oaks. You guys were, you know that as well. Both parties are present today for discussion. They did resubmit plans. You guys were emailed those today around 3, I believe it was 2 or 3. They did resubmit some corrections that were asked from the county highway engineer. I did not have a chance to go through them. It was late in the afternoon. I did see, however, there were still 2 drives. I know we have spoken a few times about the ingress and egress being 1. So that's something to look at as well. So the county highway engineer's comments were emailed to you. Per the email I got this afternoon, all those have been addressed. So that being said, we're here today to discuss the where they are with their progress getting the easement situation and all their issues and so. So
okay. So now we need to hear from Eagle View, correct? On their plans, Cindy?
Yes.
Okay. You could state for the you come up, state your name for the record, and then proceed with what you have to present.
Absolutely. Good evening. I'm Mara Hoff. I'm the attorney with Defer Moran, 400 South Walnut Street in Muncie, Indiana, 47305. Here with me is Andrew Rozelle with AR Engineering. He's the engineer for the North Mills project, and the owner, Chad Green, is here as well. As was already mentioned in the original overview, this has been pending with me for some time. I've only been involved in a couple of months, so I can't comment specifically as to what was addressed before, but in looking through your prior minutes, it seemed as though most things were in order other than this easement dispute. So what we decided to do was to shrink our proposed development by 5 or 6 lots, removing all development from the east side where the disputed easement is located. So now our subdivision is for 25 single family lots with small attached garages. They are all on half acre lots and will all be served with full utilities and a 12-foot easement. We did receive the comments of the highway director and everything that was technical that needed an additional marking on the plat or something shaded differently. The engineers have updated all of that and that was submitted this morning. And then even if you are looking on the old ones, those are very, very minor updates, so they do not affect the angles you were looking at. So first, the subdivision does have 4 very short streets, and by short, I mean that they go across 4 to 5 lots maximum. Those are labeled on your map as Eagle Loop East, Eagle Loop West, Eagle Loop North, and Hummingbird Lane. My client and the engineer had discussed with the prior county engineer in the fall that these actually would be deemed marginal access streets requiring a 40-foot right-of-way. So that is how the plans would direct. Due to the small nature of the development and the lack of being directly connected to any kind of commercial center, we felt that sidewalks were completely unnecessary. It's easy to get around in a neighborhood that small without the addition of sidewalks. We also felt people purchasing a half-acre lot would appreciate the additional space in the front to not be taken up by a sidewalk. Additionally, the current engineer did ask if the 2-foot buffer would be made of gravel, and we believe that our homeowners would prefer that grass, the 2-foot buffer between the street and the property line, and that was previously approved as well. Asked if that continues to hold. As far as the entrance, so the current engineer had asked whether Eagle Loop East could be the only main entrance to the whole subdivision. While that's not our ideal, we felt for public safety reasons, there should be 2 points of access to the neighborhood so the fire and EMS could get to the properties quickly without winding through a neighborhood. If it is the preference of this commission, we will cap off west a big cul-de-sac and make it only one entrance. So we do have a preference, but we will leave it up to you because we are amenable to either. There was a question about an old field tile that is right in the middle of the platted area. That is slated for removal. The new drainage plan, which has already been approved by the county surveyor, involves adequate ditching and culverts to handle all of the water, and it continues to allow it to course on its natural path towards the southeast corner of the lot. So that will be out. There was one location where a 14-foot easement had been indicated. That was a typo. All utilities are within the 12-foot easement. Other than that, I will allow the demonstrators to bring up whatever their issues may be. But we do feel very strongly that the subdivision plat meets the standards for drainage and right-of-way and lot size. All of the technical aspects are met, and we have removed the conflicted area from your jurisdiction, so you need not address that if we can handle that civilly outside. So what we're asking for today is this preliminary plat approval from you, and the engineer or I would be happy to answer any specific questions you have about it.
certain that that was addressed and brought up because of that pile of those under the road there, but I was not in that team. So that has been approved with regular words.
Okay, I see a better one.
Yeah, did you get the 11 by 17?
He's got it right here.
Did you, in regards to my email, that was really extra research?
Yeah, it's me. Good evening. My name's Andrew Rosell, and I've really had the pleasure of meeting all of you in person over the past couple of years. But we're the civil engineer on the project, and have worked closely with many of the department heads. As most of you probably know, we went through the process last year, felt that we were in great shape, had all our approvals, and I believe that's what I was capable for. so to speak.
Is there any pending legal action happening right now?
No, to my knowledge, there has been nothing filed in court of law. Ms. Chrissy and I have corresponded via letter and telephone.
So addressing that concern that was brought up at the last meeting, that's when the owner decided to remove those lots and proceed with the development and avoiding those lots and working them out at a later date. Essentially, not developed lots and remaining as is.
So are you considering that a potential future?
Potential future development if things progress.
If we're to get resolved and our client would have sufficient space there, we would come back to you for another very small subdivision, maybe 4,000 or 5,000, but if it does not, then it will remain undeveloped.
So you're not asking those to be part of the pre-plat approval for this?
No.
Thank you. We'll have a presentation of President of the Corporation. You guys would like to present to the board. Again, state your name.
Firm Bennett, Benning, and Cleary. I have Kisby Rissy here with me as well, with his attorneys. Our address is 415 Columbia Street, Suite 1000, Lafayette, Indiana, 47901. We're here on behalf of Fresno tonight. Fresno's owner, Kelly Good, is also here, as well as our engineer, Jason Miller. All right, to get started, a week ago we sent you a rather large submission, about 15 pages, that really outlined a lot of the issues and concerns and problems that Fresno has voiced over the last several meetings. Combined mostly into one document because it's a lot to talk about, it's a lot to remember, and we wanted to put it all in one space. So I trust that you've all read it, and tonight we don't have a lot of time to get into all of our issues, our concerns, our problems. We're just gonna go over a few important items. In front of you, we have a couple maps, two maps we're going to review together, as well as a one-page summary of our submission, again, just to hit home some of our really important key points. So I'd first like to just go through the first map with you, one that's not colored. This is a picture of the proposed subdivision, along with the Fresno property. The Fresno property is to the north. You can see right here this rectangle shape. To the south, you can see here is the proposed subdivision plat. On the left, of the proposed subdivision, we have a 50-foot easement. In that easement is a roadway and an underground sewage pipe. It carries raw sewage through this pipe all the way along the side of the proposed subdivision, across Fresno's property, and to our rectangular building here, that's our sewer treatment facility where it is treated. And then it comes down here on the right side of our the proposed subdivision, out the affluent line. You'll see several manholes, and then it discharges out here down by the bottom. So the proposed subdivision is surrounded on three sides by a sewer treatment facility and its equipment. So you'll turn with me to the next page here quick. In our submission, we have categorized the issues, problems, and concerns into three substantive categories. The first one being the health, safety, and the well-being of the residents and neighbors to the proposed subdivision. The second one being the non-compliance with rules, regulations, and laws. The third being the unresolved boundary and easement dispute between the Cranes and Fresno. So this drawing here as an illustration of only the second of our points, which is the non-compliance with rules, laws, and regulations. I'm gonna kind of go through just a couple of these things, items here with you. Again, it's more laid out in our submission and along the key on the side. I think some of these things are really critical and they're really, really important. So again, in red, fire engine red here, we have our sewage treatment lines and our facility here to kind of put it into some context. I'm a visual person, so I assume other people are too. That's our fire engine red lines. The darker red line here illustrates that 500 foot rule that we talk a lot about in our submission, where it says a new sewer treatment facility can't be built within 500 feet of a residence, which would take out all the residences here then. Again, that 600 foot rule we talk a lot about in our submission is here in this blue line right here, which again takes out several more residences here. We can go to the residences on the left side here. Bring your attention to 21 through 25. Five residences here. We have several issues and problems and concerns with these four houses in particular. We're only going to talk about a couple. Again, please refer to our submission. We talk about a much more. Again, we have a 50-foot easement. Right here, it's depicted in yellow. And on easement, we have a very busy road. That road is used for our sewage trucks, RVs, campers, our other large equipment. Okay, there's a road there that's heavily trafficked. Again, underneath the ground, we have a sewer pipe that carries raw sewage. So these houses, these five houses on here, are dangerously close to our easement that contains the busy road and the underground sewage line. First, to the busy road. Most modern houses have patios, decks, outdoor spaces, so we just kind of assume these nice houses will as well. So we drew in here, you can see 24 and 25, we've drawn in these dark boxes off the house right here, just to illustrate where a deck or a patio might be. It's our estimate that the edge of a deck or a patio is going to be 5 feet. 5 feet from our busy road. That's unsafe. Also, these residences are going to have wells. These wells are going to be dangerously close to our sewage pipe underneath the ground. Again, just a few issues that we have here. Also, something that hasn't been talked about. You'll see the green arrows at the top of the page. That illustrates the watershed that comes down through these properties. And you'll notice here at the bottom, having green too, here, 50,000 gallons of affluent discharges right here every day. That's about five swimming pools full of fluid that is trickling out each day. So we have a lot of drainage issues that have not been addressed, in addition to our line here at the bottom. Long story short is, there are many issues, problems, and concerns with this proposed subdivision. From the health and safety of the neighbors and the residents of this proposed subdivision, to the many violations of regulations, laws, and rules that we've described in our submission. And the last point I want to touch on a little bit is the unresolved boundary and easement disputes, plural, that Fresno, the owner of the property to the north, and the Cranes, this property here, one of the owners of this property, the proposed subdivision, have. Those issues have not been resolved. It is an illusion to say that just simply cutting out a few houses along here on the side is going to solve our dispute and our problem. Because these boundary disputes, these easement disputes, are not just to one particular small corner of these properties. If we can't get these resolved, we're unfortunately going to have to venture down the road of litigation, and that's going to involve both of these properties in its entirety. It would be unfair to kick this problem down the road to these residences and involve additional people in this unfortunate dispute. So I'll leave you with a question today. We have 15 pages of issues, concerns, and really huge problems, significant problems with the proposed subdivision. Not just some ticky-tacky, you know, this curb cut isn't the right size, there's not a roundabout here. Yes, there are those technical issues as well, but there are significant issues and problems that need to be resolved. Some of them don't even are likely not even to be resolved. So it's our position that this proposed subdivision needs to be denied. May I leave you with a final thought? Your job as the APC is to protect the residents of Carroll County, the neighbors, all the parties that are involved. If someone that you know, a loved one, a friend, wanted to build a $300,000 house in this subdivision, I think, in my opinion, you would want them to build here, knowing all of the significant issues with these properties. I'd like you to consider that as you're making your determination. Also, excuse me, one additional point. We haven't had a chance to review the submission that they apparently sent in today with revised plans. The documents that are in front of you, the submission, the 15 pages that we provided you last Tuesday, those are based on the plans that we had before. We haven't had a chance or an opportunity to review, and we would like that opportunity to review and comment and see if there are any additional issues you'd like to raise.
It was not forwarded to me.
We're not getting along and this is how wide this is. This is wastewater or sewage treatment plant goes to IDEM to get a permit to operate. They don't want those kinds of businesses to come into a neighborhood and try to plant themselves next to residences that already exist. It does not work in the reverse. Those IDEM regs do not apply to your decision here today. And I understand that it could be used as maybe a general guideline for how you want your community to operate, but if that were the fact, then those numbers would have needed to be put into Carroll County ordinance specifically. These public health and safety clauses that are cited over and over and over have been ruled by our state Supreme Court to not be specific enough for denial of a plat. You have to go further and have something specific that your petitioner would be able to address or deal with or expect to face at a hearing such as this. For example, if there was a flooding issue on the property, that would be a specific public health and safety issue that we would need to address. We have, and we've already got drainage approval since last November. So any concerns about this water that's being shed have already been addressed and already been approved by the surveyor. So I'm not sure why we're bringing them all up again. So the bottom line is, we don't want you to be drug into our private issue. I think my client has gone above and beyond changing this proposed development so that it would be easier for this board to be able to approve it and avoid the civil issues that are involved in it. And quite honestly, the risk that someone doesn't want to build in a development that is that close to a sewage treatment plant, that risk is on my client. We all take business risks every day. Maybe that's a benefit that affects bottom line price, but we will be disclosing the existence of this place in all our real estate documents. It's not going to be hidden from potential landowners that wish to build. So we would respectfully request that you approve this preliminary plat. We will get to work bringing some more homes and more tax dollars to Carroll. If you have any further questions,
Cindy, can we have 30 seconds just to address a couple of comments that she said?
Thank you for closing comments on this regarding that. Anybody wants to make a public comment regarding the project? Go ahead. Come on up. State your name. Has been here for 30 years.
being said, I hope you will not.
Any other comments? Sir, come on, come on, state your name.
I've not been to a meeting like this before.
You must be here. Come up to the corner where she was at and state your name.
Listen, my name's Bob Gillespie. I live across the street from the addition, and my concerns are drainage, and I own, my wife and I, Pam, own 27 acres across the street. So there are three ravines that we own that run to the bayou on Lake Freeman. The main ravine is where this runoff water is going to go. Runoff from roofs, driveways, houses, patios, whatever else is out there. That ravine has never had that kind of flood before. I know Sethlec has a big problem with that ravine, and the soils that wash out of my ravine with the water that runs through it now. So I would like to know if anything's been done, any surveys been done, on how much water is coming off all this square footage that's not going to absorb into the soil anymore, but to run off. The other part of my thought is that I believe, being a landowner, that you should have a right to do with whatever you want to do with your land. But I also understand there's caveats that exist that prevent that from happening for the good of society. I think this is one of those situations where if these problems can be worked out, which I think they probably could be, I don't want to see an addition going across, but I'm not opposed to it because I want to do with what I want to do with my land and my wife. So if these things can be worked out, and all these problems can be solved, I say go forward with it. But you have to have an enforcement agency. You have to have inspections. I don't know if Carroll County has that. So that's my two cents on the situation.
Thank you. Other comments?
I'm Bill Brown. I'm president of the Carroll County Commissioners. My wife and I live in Cutler, Indiana. I want to apologize to you for something that has happened here, and that is, if I would have fully done my job and my homework, and if my fellow commissioners had, you wouldn't be doing this now, because we wouldn't have passed it in the first place, the rezone. I greatly regret that we did that. But I can tell you that the plans were put before us, and one of my fellow commissioners said the area plans in favor of this, aren't they? And I said, yes, I believe they are. And he said, well, then we should support the area plan. And the other commissioner said, we need housing in the county, don't we? And I said, absolutely. Because nobody wants more housing than I do. He said, then we should support it. There are problems with this whole development. It is a mess. I had some reservations about it because I realized that this property is surrounded on three sides by the sewage treatment facility. One side is the raw sewage. Then you have the sewage treatment plant. Then you have the discharge line. That's all three sides of it. I was also greatly dismayed when I stopped over at Cameron's office, and I can tell you that I don't think there's been anybody that has been in that position that has had more respect and support from the county commissioners. I can tell you there's nobody than Cameron has. We love it that he's there and he's such a professional person. But I stopped over at his office and saw the plans. And I thought, wait a minute, these aren't the plans the commissioner saw. I don't like that, folks. We should be working together. We shouldn't have somebody coming into us and presenting one set of plans and coming to you and presenting another set. Those plans that came to you in the first place, and now I understand there's at least three, maybe four sets that buy in, those plans should be the same. I looked at them and here are all these storage buildings on there. And I know at a previous meeting I brought this up and I said, this is not the place for boat storage buildings to be built. And their response was, oh, these are garages for the homeowners to have if they want. That doesn't meet your description in your book of garages. A garage should be subordinate to the main home, should be on the same property as the main home, not in a long strip around it. Now they tell us, well, we're just going to put this off to the side. We're going to come back to you later and work that out. We never passed it for there to be business rentals in that property. We would have known that's not right. There is a property dispute there. There's a problem. The way I understand it, White Oaks has a 10-acre tract. And it's very plain on their legal description what they have. However, unfortunately, the developers have three or four different legal descriptions on what they have. So this is a big difference. Where those property lines are going to be. I'd also like to point out that the first thing I noticed about it was that row of homes that is going to be built right at the back fence, at the north fence, next to the sewage treatment plant. That plant, at certain times of the year, stinks. All sewage plants do. I know when they fire that thing up and there's new people there who have spent their life savings on a beautiful new home, they're going to be calling me. And I sure hope they call you too. Because they're not going to want to live next to that sewage treatment plant. And when the time comes that they have to remove the sludge and stuff out of the bottom of it, that they do in every sewage treatment plant, they're going to go right down through that access road, right in back of all the other houses. This is very poor planning. That's not the place to have it. I want to make sure I'm not walking away here and not remembering something. I want to talk to you for a minute about White Oaks itself. White Oaks is in jeopardy because of this. You all know that nothing in your homes lasts forever. That sewage treatment plant is going to have to be expanded, modernized, changed, fixed. It's going to meet new regulations. They're going to have to do it. Now, according to the state rules, they can't build a new plant within 500 feet of the houses. It was pointed out by the attorney here that that's not a reciprocal thing, that they can build a house within 500 feet. Now, in your area plan, your people have very wisely put in that you can't build a CAFO within so many feet of a home. And they put the reciprocal in that you can't build a home within the same number of feet from the CAFO. The state hasn't been that smart. As in a lot of things they do, they've left that wide open for conjecture. So, while he can't build a new sewage treatment plant, can't dramatically increase the capacity, can't make it meet modern codes, which it does today, but may not in the future, they can build houses right against it. I've heard it said that this is going to be a big boom to our county because they're going to be building $300,000 homes out there. That's what we want. That's what everybody wants. Nice middle-class housing. At the same time, you should see what's going on at White Oaks. White Oaks was desolate. Those of you that have been around that area know that the weeds were this high when they acquired it. county, the township had to come out and pay to keep it mowed down because the neighbors were all complaining so much when it was in bankruptcy. Things were falling apart. Then Carroll County was lucky enough to get a first-class architect who bought it. And I'm telling you, he knows what he's doing. And he's building back to the right. Those homes, the number of homes we're talking about in this subdivision are way outnumbered by what he's doing down there. He's right now got, if you go down there, it's a beehive of activity in any case. There are six of the cottages that have been torn down to nothing but two befores and trusses and being rebuilt. He's putting close to $300,000 into each one of these cottages. Right now, six are being done. I don't know the true number of it, they can tell you, but I think there's at least a dozen more cottages that are going to be done. There were up to 18 right there. We're talking about 20-some homes here. He's doing that same thing. Plus, there's this great big building down there that used to be Pirate's Roost. And it is a very good building, but it has been damaged by vandals terribly. His plan for it, or one of the things that I'm hearing about that he'd like to do, is turn it into beautiful townhouses right there overlooking the lake. Much more property value for us. Not allowing White Oaks to continue on will shut us off on all these good things that are going on. Right now there's a beautiful place for boat docks being built. I think boat docks, okay. These aren't normal boat docks. Mark doesn't do normal things. I'm a get by, however I can. He's not, he does it right. These are gonna be beautiful boat docks with lifts, with upper deck on them for you to enjoy sitting out there and enjoying the day. It's a major construction. They had a boat ramp there that you could get stuck on because you drop off the end of the thing and your axle falls out on the end and you get stuck. The best boat ramp access on Lake Freeman is there now, just completed. Beautiful wide concrete ramp. They're building the piers along the side of it right now. This is a tremendous project that's there. And you have upon you the responsibility of deciding whether it's going to continue or whether it's going to be in jeopardy. There are at least 50 people employed there today. There will be more. The restaurant there will